We're done here. Dismissed.
I've sent off the Pharos report, Commander. You want me to patch you through to the Council?
Sure, go ahead.
Patch him through, Joker.
Setting up the link now, Commander.
Commander, Exogenia should have told us about the Thorian. It would have made your job much easier.
You might have been able to capture it for study instead of destroying it.
No, it's better off this way.
The Thorian like to enslave minds. Anyone who studied it would have ended up as one of its thralls.
Perhaps it's for the best, then. At least the colony was saved.
Of course it was saved. Shepard would go to any lengths to help a human colony.
I really do not like this guy. Out of the three of them, he's a... Don't want to say. I help everyone.
Being human had nothing to do with it. They were in trouble.
Admirable. But sometimes specters have to make sacrifices. I hope you're willing to do that when the time comes.
Goodbye, Commander. We will be waiting for your next report.
Someday I should just disconnect them for the hell of it. Like, we're done here. Alright. Before we head to our next objective, talk to everybody.
Yes, Commander?
Carry on, Presley.
Yes, ma'am.
Nothing new here. Oh, turn around. Kind of feel like Joker won't have anything new to say, but...
Hey, Commander, next time we touch down, let's try not to park the ship in a colony of mutant zombies. Just thinking out loud here.
Yeah. It's just his little line when we, you know, go to talk to him, that's it.
I have to go.
Alright, see you.
Same as last time. After we finished at Novaria, I believe it was. Let's go talk to everybody. Oh. Scimitar 6, Hurricane 6, Combat Scanner 6. I think we don't have that. So two shotguns? Rex might be able to use this. I'll get rid of that one. And combat sensor? Combat scanner? 6. Okay, good. We have two of them, but one of us might be able to use the 5. I think Rex uses a combat scanner. Not sure what he's up to. Caden. Well, awkward approaching.
We haven't had time together since our last chat. A lot was said when we talked.
And?
Something to add, Lieutenant, or are you just breaking in your thesaurus?
Sorry, I'm not sure where I stand. You seem a bit distracted by someone.
Awesome. You mean Liara?
Someone? You're referring to our young Prothean expert.
I think she's older than both of us put together, but, yeah. There's a lower deck rumor that she's, interested in you as more than a source of Prothean data.
Yay!
She's a very interesting lady. To my, tastes, but, I never claimed to be big on alien culture.
I'm loving this, by the way. Are you jealous?
You seem awfully worried about my personal affairs.
My personal affairs.
It's just that we don't have much downtime these days. I like being around you, but I don't want to take up your personal time.
I don't need this aggravation. It's not like that.
Look, there's nothing between Liara.
Oh, that? Oh.
What's the real issue here, Caden?
No, I would have affirmed that.
Shepard. At least. Not when you're around. I'm just looking for an ear. The debriefing wasn't the right place to say how ridiculous this is. Seems like every other race in the galaxy is wrapped up in their own problems. They don't want to see what's coming.
Now, when I... I hope I didn't screw things up. When I said that it's not like that, I meant to say that he's not wasting my time or something like that, or whatever he said. The last thing he said. Not about Liara. Well, you can't blame them.
Wanting to believe everything will be fine? Sounds like human nature to me.
Yeah, I guess some things carry across species well enough. I should remember that after what happened with Furnace.
So what happened? I don't remember Furnace.
Don't tell me you and Furnace hugged on graduation day.
Nah.
Before I met Furnace, I knew as much as any other civilian. Aliens were weird. Superior and tried to tell us what to do.
Aliens were weird.
26 years since first contact. That's not a lot of time to understand them.
Oh, really? Only 26?
Who made me see how human aliens are. They're not different or special. They're jerks and saints, just like us.
Yep.
Hell, by the time I got payback, I didn't even want it anymore.
What happened?
I don't see you snapping very easily. What finally did it?
He hurt a girl. Broke her arm. She reached for a glass of water instead of pulling it biotically. She just wanted a drink without getting a nosebleed, you know? Like an idiot, I stood up. Didn't know what I was gonna do, just something. And Furnace lost it. Beat the crap out of me. Kept shouting how they should have bombed us back to the Stone Age. And that's when the knife came up.
What?
A military-issue talon, right in my face. I cut loose. Full biotic kick right in the teeth. Almost as strong as I can manage now. At 17, that's something.
Huh. So, yes, he wanted to punish her? They were only allowed to use biotics for everything they do or something? I'm not sure. I get that, but, yeah, impressive.
Sat down by a kid. Furnace must have hated that.
He didn't have time to hate it. I killed him.
Ooh.
Snapped his neck. They probably could have saved him if they got him to an infirmary quick enough. But they didn't. Caused a stir when they shipped him home. Bot training was shut down. Kinetics folded a couple of years later.
Really?
It's funny. I'm not sure which of us got the worst of what happened.
Must have freaked you out.
Hey, you were just a kid. How'd you deal with that mess?
I didn't. Not at the time. I wasn't upset he was dead, but I was sorry that I'd killed him. So I dropped out of sight for a bit. They let me go. I guess they wanted it to blow over as much as I did. I came back on my terms because I wanted to serve. So, yeah, I hated that Turian. But he wasn't a Turian to me. He was Furnace.
Oh my god, so horrible. That last one. I respect that.
And here I was concerned you were damaged goods.
I've got a few scratches and dents. Hope they just give me character. I don't think we'll be operating without support for much longer. Pretty soon, not even the Council will be able to ignore what's going on.
Mm-hmm.
Glad you'll be here when it's over, Shepard. I'm looking forward to some shore leave.
We always get these choices at the end, and he says the same thing, so...
We'll talk later, Caden.
I'd like that.
Go next time. I hope he doesn't say anything to Liara. Asari military doctrine and about Solarians biology. The Asari military resembles a collection of tribal warrior bands with no national structure. Each community organizes its own unit as the local see fit and elect a leader to command them. Units from populous cities are large and well-equipped, while those from farm villages may only be a few women with small arms. There is no uniform. Everyone wears what they like. The Asari military is not an irregular militia, however. Those who serve are full-time professionals. The average Asari huntress, I like that, huntress, is in the maiden stage of her life and has devoted 20 to 30 years to studying the martial arts. Asari choose to be warriors at a young age, and their education from that point is dedicated to sharpening the mind and body for that sole purpose. When they retire, they possess an alarming proficiency for killing. Huntresses fight individually or in pairs, depending on the tactics preferred in their town. One-on-one, a huntress is practically unbeatable, possessing profound tactical insight. A hunter's age, and a dancer's grace and alacrity. Biotics are common enough that some capability is a requirement to be trained as a huntress. Lack of biotic talent excludes a young Asari from military service. While fluid and mobile, Asari can't stand up in a firestorm the way a Krogan, Turian, or human could. Since their units are small and typically lack heavy armor and support weapons, they are almost incapable of fighting a conventional war, particularly one of a defensive nature. So Asari units typically undertake special operations missions. Like an army of ninja, they are adept at ambush, infiltration, and assassination, demoralizing and defeating their enemies through intense, focused guerrilla strikes. As a popular Turian saying puts it, the Asari are the finest warriors in the galaxy. Fortunately, there are not many of them. In Solarian's biology. Solarians are noted for their high-speed metabolism, which allows them to function on just 1 hour of sleep a day. Wow. Their minds and bodies work faster than most sapient races, making them restless or hyperactive. The drawback of this active metabolism is a short lifespan of around 40 human years. Wow. Now that's interesting. In a lot of, like, fantasy RPG settings, all the other races there are pretty much equal to or live a lot longer than we do. Here's one who lives only 40 years. The Solarians are amphibian, haplodiploid egg layers. Unfertilized eggs produce males, and fertilized eggs produce females. Really? You don't even have to fertilize an egg to give birth to a male Solarian. Once a year, a Solarian female will lay a clutch of dozens of eggs. Social rules prevent all but a fraction from being fertilized. As a result, 90% of the species is male. They want more males than females? Solarians have photographic memories and rarely forget a fact. They also possess a form of psychological imprinting, tending to defer to those they knew in their youth. Solarian hatching is a solemn ritual in which the clan Dalatras, matriarch, isolates herself with the eggs. The young Solarians psychologically imprint on her and tend to defer to her wishes. During the hatching of daughters, the Dalatrases of the mother and father's clans are present at the imprinting. This ensures the offspring have equal loyalty to both, ensuring the dynastic and political unity. That's pretty interesting. Really don't know a lot about the Solarians compared to everyone else we've run across. Nothing new in primary. Alright, there's no one down here, right? There's nothing to look at. More stuff. This panel is weird, almost like it could be... I don't know, is that part of the outer hull? It almost looks like a display window that was, like, closed off, like a viewport or something. Right. We go down for the rest, right? Rex.
Shepard.
So you'd rather be a merc than help your people?
I'm a fighter. It's what I do.
Aren't you at all worried about what will happen to the Krogan?
What the hell do you want me to do about it, Shepard? I'm tired of sticking my ass on the line and getting nothing for it.
We had this conversation, I don't remember. That's your reason?
So you're just giving up on your people?
I didn't want to say that.
I gave up on fighting for a lost cause. I'm not like you, Shepard. I'm no hero. Bottom line, killing for credits simplifies things.
I suppose.
You ever think about helping your people?
I try not to. But there's a lot of Krogan mercs out there. I'm always running into them. Half the time I'm being paid to kill them. But that's just part of the job. You don't get to pick who your enemies are.
So long, Rex.
Shepard.
Ashley?
Commander?
How you doing?
What's your opinion of the last mission?
Gotta admire those Colonials. That's about the worst place for a colony I've ever seen.
Agreed.
Given the option, I'd get the hell out of Dodge.
Do you have a few minutes to talk? One-on-one?
I'm off duty until tomorrow. I was gonna have a small drink. Bit of a celebration. If you're interested.
What's the occasion?
What's the occasion?
It's Armistice Day, when the First Contact War ended. My family always marks it.
Yeah.
Since I'm the only Williams aboard, I thought I'd ask you.
I'm flattered.
Seems like an odd thing to celebrate. That was 26 years ago.
In our family, it's not really a celebration, more like an obligation. Don't tell me you don't know about my family. My commanders always find out. It's not in my files or something?
Something she hasn't told us? What?
I don't know what you're talking about.
I'm General Williams' granddaughter, the commander of the Shanxi garrison in the war. The only human ever to surrender to an alien race.
Huh. Now I understand.
I see. That's why you drive yourself so hard.
A Williams has to be better than the best, if only to avoid suspicion. That's what my dad told me the night before he retired. It takes a special kind of big head to march into a job where your family's blacklisted. I did it anyway. I'm not gonna let our name go down with Arnold and Quisling. Granddad deserved better than that.
Shanxi, huh?
As I recall, your grandfather held out for a long time.
The Turians wrecked the orbitals in the first wave and occupied the major cities. They sat in orbit, dropping rocks on anything that moved. Huh. Granddad dispersed the troops. But when they went into the cities for supplies, the Turians would wreck a block to eliminate one fire team. Civilians were dying, his troops were starving, and he couldn't contact Alliance High Command. So he surrendered the garrison.
Grandfather?
What happened to your grandfather after the war?
He was relieved of command as soon as Shanxi was liberated. They brought him back to Earth in irons, but there was never a trial. They quietly demoted him and stuck him behind a desk. He retired a year later and spent the rest of his life working construction in the colonies. Sometimes we hear about attempts to get him exonerated in some official way. Nothing ever comes of him.
So that's why you dislike aliens.
Is this why you're always going on about the Council?
If everyone else can look at Shanxi and say, this is why humanity needs to be stronger, then so can I. I'm entitled. So now you know. Gonna kick me off the ship, Skipper?
Of course not.
You're part of the team, Williams. I don't care what your grandfather did or didn't do.
Not to get all cheesy, but you're the first CEO who's ever said that to me. Thanks, Skipper. But anyway, I've got things to do before we land. I'm sure you do too.
Don't know if we're still invited to our celebration, but...
Dismissed, Chief.
Ma'am.
Codex. Planetary assault, space combat. Planetary assaults are complicated if the target is a habitable garden world. The attackers cannot approach the defenders straight on. The Citadel Conventions prohibit the use of large kinetic impactors against habitable worlds. In a straight-on attack, any misses plow into the planet behind the defending fleet. If the defenders position themselves between the attackers and the planet, they can fire at will while the attacker risks hitting the planet. Successful assaults on garden worlds hinge upon up-to-date intelligence. Attackers need to determine where the enemy's defenses are so that they may approach from an angle that allows them to fire with no danger of collateral damage. Note, this is not necessary for hostile worlds. Once control of orbit has been lost, defensive garrisons disperse into the wilderness. An enemy with orbital superiority can bombard surface forces with impunity. The best option for defenders is to hide and collect reconnaissance in anticipation of relief forces. Given the size of a planet, it is impractical to garrison entire conquered worlds. Fortunately, colonization efforts tend to focus on building up a dozen or fewer areas. Ground forces occupy the spaceports, industrial facilities, and major population centers. The wilderness is patrolled by unmanned aerial vehicles and satellite reconnaissance. If a defender unit is spotted, air mobile rapid deployment units and satellite artillery are used to pin down and destroy them. Garrus. Oh, you got a terminal now. Isn't he always, like, kneeling down by that tire?
Commander, what can I do for you?
What's the matter?
Something bothering you?
It's Saren. I'm starting to wonder whether we'll ever find him. He's always one step ahead of us, and he's got those damn Geth.
Don't worry.
We're getting close, Garrus. We'll find him.
I wish I had your confidence. I just can't stand the thought of him getting away with everything he's done. I know you're doing everything you can, and if anyone can catch him, it's you, but if there's anything else I can do to help, anything, just tell me what you want me to do, and I'll do it.
Are you worried? I just said he was worried.
I understand your concern, but we will find him. Just make sure you're ready to go when we do.
Yes, ma'am. You can count on me. Thanks for hearing me out. I appreciate it. Can I ask you something, Commander?
Of course.
What is it?
No, goodbye.
Are you worried that the Council might be protecting Saren? I mean, they were really dragging their heels before. What if we find him, bring him back to the Citadel, and they refuse to act?
It's possible.
You seem to have some thoughts on this. Speak your mind, Garrus.
You just did.
Well, maybe we shouldn't give them a chance, Commander. In my opinion, Saren's too dangerous to be kept alive. Too much could happen. He could escape, or the Council might let him go. If we find him, when we find him, I say we make sure we stop him permanently.
Agreed.
I'm glad you see it that way. I never had any intention of capturing that bastard. When I see him, he dies.
Good. The Council won't like it, but they can't stop you either. You see, this is why I want to be a Spectre. You never have to worry about bureaucratic idiots making a mess of everything.
I don't see a reason to tell him, don't let me down. Dismissed.
Just make sure you're ready when it happens.
Yes, ma'am.
More codex. Turian's government. The Turian government is a hierarchical meritocracy. While it has great potential for misuse, this is tempered by the civic duty and personal responsibility Turians learn in childhood. Turians have 27 citizenship tiers, beginning with civilians, client races, and children. The initial period of military service is the second tier. Formal citizenship is conferred as the third tier after boot camp. For client races, citizenship is granted after the individual musters out. Higher-ranked citizens are expected to lead and protect subordinates. Lower-ranked citizens are expected to obey and support superiors. Promotion to another tier of citizenship is based on the personal assessments of one's superiors and co-rankers. Throughout their lives, Turians ascend to higher tiers and are occasionally demoted to lower ones. The stigma associated with demotion lies not on the individual, but on those who promoted him when he wasn't ready for additional responsibility. This curbs the tendency to promote individuals into positions beyond their capabilities. Settling into a role and rank is not considered stagnation. Turians value knowing one's own limitations more than being ambitious. At the top are the Primarchs, who each rule a colonization cluster. The Primarchs vote on matters of national import. They otherwise maintain a hands-off policy, trusting the citizens on each level below them to do their jobs competently. Turians enjoy broad freedoms. So long as one completes his duties and does not prevent others from completing theirs, nothing is forbidden. For example, there are no laws against recreational drug use, but if someone is unable to complete his duties due to drug use, his superiors step in. Judicial proceedings are interventions. Peers express their concerns and try to convince the offender to change. If rehabilitation fails, Turians have no qualms about sentencing dangerous individuals to life at hard labor for the state. Oh, that was a shorter conversation with him.
Looking for supplies?
Let's see what you've got.
You bet, Commander.